Want to call the September 1st, 2016 meeting of the Ascension Parish Council to order. Everyone please stand for the invocation, remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance. Name Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Dear Lord, we ask that you give us patience in our deliberations. Lord, we ask that we extend ourselves to do as much we can for the citizens of Ascension Parish. We ask that you bring everybody safely through this tragic event. It's very devastating within their souls, not just the loss of the homes. Lord, on this day we ask for a special blessing for the Diaz family, for the loss of Mr. Chester Diaz, a good statesman. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
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 Pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Madam Secretary, please note that Councilman Lawler and Councilman Dempsey Lambert will not make it tonight. And I believe Councilman Johnson should be stepping indoor. Everybody's running into traffic, so he should be here shortly. Chair's additions, we have none. Presentations, we'll move right into that. Proclamation to proclaim September 1st, 2016 as Lemons Day in Ascension Parish.
Mr. Lemon, you'll come up. The Lemon family has been a cornerstone of Donaldsonville for many, many years. And today we proclaim in this the Lemon Day after 180 years of service. I think they deserve a big hand for that. You know, as a kid, I bought clothes in the store, and I mean, you went from one department to the other. It was just amazing, and they had so many different businesses. And you know, not too long ago, we recognized the Cokies for 100 years. Well, this is 180 years, so just we want to just thank the Lemon family for everything they have done for Ascension Parish in Donaldsonville.
Thank y'all so much.
Thank you. Would you like to speak?
No, sir. We're glad we're here, and we're very honored that the parish is recognizing our family.
Well, we're honored with the history that your family has within our parish.
Okay. So, come on up, Councilman.
Thank you. We'll move right into agenda item number 6, Parish President's Report. Ms. Matassa.
Councilman and Council Lady. Today I met with Cassidy's office, which had some FEMA representatives. But before we do this, Chairman, can we do that emergency for that elevation deal? Is it too late to add it to the agenda? We need to suspend the inundation.
That's just an administrative order during the
Great. Okay. I'm sorry.
You can do that by executive order now.
I wasn't told. I'm sorry. Thank you. But anyway, today I met with Cassidy's office, and FEMA was there, and they brought up the fact that if we change that inundation rule, it would not hurt our FEMA insurance, I mean, our flood insurance, which is so very important. And I brought Marcia, our floodplain manager, with us to ask all of those questions. Now, they verbally told us that it would not, as long as we gave a permit of a foot above the BFE. Now, they're going to give it to us in writing, but also told us that if, in most of Santa Maria is in the AE zone, mm-hmm. someone gets a trailer, we can put it in that yard, and it won't be set no higher than 44 will be the maximum height they'll set it.
That's the temporary trailer.
It's the temporary trailers, and we can approve that 6 months at a time. Up to 18 months is the total length of you can have that there without hurting your rating. Now, as far as getting the trailers, I don't know any more than y'all know, basically. We talked about the new FEMA. Well, I'll tell you what, I think we all realize it's the old FEMA that's here. You know, we need answers for housing, answers for the flood zones, answers for claims, and just on and on. We do have our third manager of FEMA in Ascension Parish in 2 weeks. So that's getting changed regularly. Yesterday, we met with Garrett Graves and his staff. He had his whole staff down from Washington and Baton Rouge to talk about our needs for the recovery package. And I'm going to go to the East Ascension Drainage Board to ask for a resolution to support the congressman to do a drainage plan for the regional area to work with our neighbors to get rid of, you know, not just do one parish at a time, to do some major federal work. According, Mr. Graves has a very good plan that he'll be submitting in Washington and needs our support, which I'll get somebody there at that meeting to talk about. Tonight, it's been many, many years that we've talked about the water company, and tonight I'm asking you to approve this People Water Service deal that we have has been cleared by our attorneys. And you know, they satisfied that everything is good with the system. And we need it because we can consolidate it and produce our own water. I have signed six contracts that just was extending. Some of them are renewals. The DRC debris contract, Ralph Supermarket for feeding emergency workers, Republic Service, which the dumpsters, vector disease control, that's for that aerial spraying for mosquitoes, which you're going to hear from mosquito control later on. Endura Group for troubleshooting the pumps at the Marvin Boat in Henderson Bayou Station. You do know that one pump went down at Marvin Bro and one pump went down at Henderson Bayou. So that was that company's in for. Did a contract with Brown and Root for the installation and operation of the pumps on the bluff and swamp area. Overtime total as of August 28th was $464,000. At this time, I'd like to bring up David in Mosquito Control to give y'all an overview of what's going on with the mosquitoes right now.
Good afternoon, Councilman, Council Lady Cazzo. I was asked to give a briefing on the Mosquito Control Department and currently where we stand. We're very fortunate at our building on 431, we got maybe 5 inches of water, but we got some wallpaper peeling in a little mold, so we had to move out. And we're very fortunate to be in the administration building in the back hooked up to these cubicles, but it works. Our computers are hooked up, our phones are hooked up, the same line, so when people call, which at the moment we're getting very busy. Currently we spray in 7 nights a week with our adult siding trucks to go out. We're doing a lot of personal requests. This situation is rare also for mosquito control because it's it's a flood situation, but you got to understand the cycle of the mosquito, which mosquitoes need water, period. Without water, they can't breed. So a lot of these eggs that you can't see were washed away in certain areas. And we're not sure exactly how they're going to produce because the female has to bite. She's the only one that bites. And the blood is not because they're hungry, because they need a protein to produce an egg cycle. So in some areas that's been flooded and drained, we're not sure if there's going to be a hatchery, which is an explosion of eggs, or not. However, in some areas, like the Ridge Road and Bluff, is holding water, shallow water, and draining slow. We have a complex problem of mosquitoes in that area. So currently we're spraying, like I said, seven nights a week with adelsonic trucks. We're confident in certain areas we can maintain that. We're putting traps out throughout the parish, which is we're taking counts of mosquitoes in those traps in different areas throughout the parish. And as those numbers increase, then we feel confident that if we have to come in, we have a aviation contract in place to spray for aero spraying. At the moment, the numbers are not extremely high. Of course, in some areas they are, but parish-wide, they're not at the moment. But 10 days to 2 weeks, we most probably would get a pretty good mix on what's going on in the parish in that direction, if we need to go aviation or not. I got a phone call from Tulane School of Medicine, Tropical Medicine in New Orleans, and we affiliate with these people through the LMCA, which is Louisiana Mosquito Control Association. And Dr. Dawn Wesson wants to come down and give some special traps out in special areas we're going to show up, which is called gravid traps and over traps, which can trap the AD species, which is a species carrying Zika virus. Which we are fortunate in Louisiana and in Ascension Parish, the most common species is the Culex. However, which carries the West Nile, the AEDs is rare, but it can be identified. And since Tulane's coming down, we welcome it with open arms because we might have some AEDs in our area. We're not sure yet. But because of Zika, it's extremely important that we try to pin down if we've got some species in those areas. So I would report back to the parish president and the council and give you information within a few weeks when the reports start to come in. If we would decide to go with aerial spraying is a quick fix, okay? What I mean quick fix is they have to spray at the right time. In other words, these traps are so important that the numbers are right, that we feel like the professionals helping us, that the eggs hatched, and within 10 to 15 days, we have to squeeze the trigger on aviation and be more productive because the numbers are there, increased numbers. And if we feel that happens, we'll let y'all know and make a decision if you want to spray those areas. It's extremely expensive. For instance, 1 acre would be $2.13 on the contract per acre. They're using a product by the name of Dibrone, which is accepted by the military, the government, Department of Health and Hospitals, the state of Louisiana. It's the number one product used by the Air Force. It's a heavy product that gets down into the bushes and anything else. Very effective, but it has to be used at the right timing, like I said, like I explained to you about the eggs hatching. So I recommend at the moment, let's see where we stand with these traps and these numbers in these different areas. I'm confident in certain areas of the parish we can maintain with our ground trucks. We don't have big problems in the West Bank, for instance. Of course, most of the water was on the east side regardless. And if we have problems there, apparently that's where it's going to occur. And we can target areas. In other words, we can take this plane, this contract we used them before, and says, okay, look, we got 5 plots in Ascension Parish, 4 plots on the east side. That's just, when I say a plot, I'm talking about maybe a combination of a district or two, depending on your terrain. 1 plot targeted, which we could target because I would say this is the area we're having problems. You're looking at around 20,000 for one plot. However, FEMA at the current time is kicking in 75% and the state 25%. There's talk about possibility of 90%, 10% FEMA. We don't know yet for sure, but for sure right now, currently, we've got approved at 75, 25. So if we had to activate, I would recommend target spraying. In other words, areas of the parish we feel and the professionals with me feel like that's areas more sensitive to the Dibrone. And that's what I recommend to the parish. Besides that, right now, as to my knowledge, we don't have any domestic Zika cases in Louisiana, in Ascension Parish. Apparently, this is my information is that there's some travel cases that appear to be, but not domestic, meaning internal. But domestic can travel, travel could turn into domestic because it could be transmitted from a person that traveled to some area with Zika, get bitten, transmitted, and bite another person, and eventually that's going to happen most probably, like the West Nile virus. But the big problem with Zika is birth defects, okay, with young females or pregnancies. So with that said, that's my outtake on what's going on right now. We're not as busy to be expected. I think within the next 10 days, a lot of these eggs start to hatch. We're kind of like know what part of the parish is really getting infested with mosquitoes. And if it does, then I'll report back to you. And like I said, you can make decisions on the comments I just made. Any questions?
Thank you. Anything? Ms. Cazzo has a question.
Yes, ma'am.
First, a comment. I want to thank you for your responsiveness. Certainly, we've asked that there be spraying done in my communities.
Yes, ma'am.
Particularly the Ridge Road, the Bluff Road, Alligator Bayou, and Highway 74 area that had so much water and now still has standing water. So I thank you for your responsiveness. But I want you to know you don't have to call me to ask if you can spend the money to aerial spray. Okay. That's one phone call you don't have to make.
I understand.
And whatever it costs, these mosquitoes are carrying off my babies back
there. Yeah. Well, it's going to be up to the decision regardless. I understand what you're saying. But again, let me go with the professionals to feel like the right time to do it because it's very expensive, but it's very effective. But let's do it at the most effective time that the professionals agree with, saying, David, the time is the next 3 nights to do it. Then you had the mercy of Mother Nature saying the wind, because it's so important. The wind's right, no rain, because the flight wants to be right.
I'm 100% in support of doing it at the right time, but I do not want money to be a factor.
Okay, I got you. Another thing is, professionally wise, my experience is that areas that need application, we're most probably looking at 2 or 3 applications within a month, because that's the way it works with mosquito eggs. They'll hatch another 10 to 15 days later, and you're just going back to square one if you don't pull the trigger on another flight to eliminate the next eggs that hatched. So with that said, we love siding areas also, but that particular area, the waters, it's a perfect time bomb for mosquitoes because it's shallow water. And it's breeding mosquitoes and it's draining slow.
Thank y'all so much for paying attention to it.
Yes, ma'am. We appreciate it. Any more questions?
Yes, Mr.
Yes, sir.
Lambert.
Yeah, David.
Okay.
And we know you've been in the business a while, and we trust you. And if we need a special meeting to, if you need approval from this council to do so, you just say the word, because we want to be on top of it just like you are.
I understand. I appreciate it. The program is 19 years old. I've been in charge for 16. Yeah. You know that. We brought in surveillance and all, but it is what it is. And my look at it is, like I said, to our advantage, we could target. We got professional. We're very fortunate. We have a good airport that they used before, and we could target areas, okay? Right. And it's all GPS with these sketches. This is previous flights we did in the past.
Yeah.
So these are really, there's 2 big companies in the country, okay? Right. This is one of them.
Appreciate what you do, David.
Yes, sir. Any more questions?
No. Thank you, Jim.
Yes, sir.
We got the contract in place, and, it's just another thing we're doing. So he doesn't have, if the stars line up, we're going to pull the trigger on it. And the chairman can tell you, the governor told us we would definitely get 90-10 because there's so much devastation, and all of those 13 parishes together is going to be way over $620 million. $620 million. I've met with the Red Cross today about winding down. They still have 175 people in there. A percentage of them have animals, but not a whole lot of them. And we're going to be winding down in the next couple of weeks with the shelter. I'm meeting with Kara tomorrow about the animal situation in the shelter right now. So that's all I have right now. And next week, Rick Weber will give, not next week, but next meeting, he'll give y'all an in-depth report on everything.
Ken, while we're talking about the FEMA, the whole FEMA deal is just to bring everybody up to board. We've been fighting for a couple weeks and talking with them. Just to let everybody know right now we got approximately 108, 110 FEMA inspectors in the parish, okay? And just basically the scenario is if you got flood insurance, then you you know, if you put in a claim, if you were flooded, whether you had insurance or not, you put in a claim, and you put in a claim to your insurance, you'd have an adjuster from your insurance. That's working different. The FEMA inspector that's going around is going around to quantify your claim, that is true claim, and also he's looking at all the damage you have and all the making assessments. But what that guy's doing is he's looking at that $33,000, okay? That's whether you have flood insurance or not. He's looking at that, how much of that $33,000 they've been talking about for 2 weeks, whether you qualify for or not. So, you know, and on the, they call the trailers, they call them, they don't use the word now, they got manufactured housing units, and they're pretty good. They look good anyway. I never got inside one, but so we started with the thing 2 weeks ago. Most of you guys been working with us, and that you can't put it in a flood zone. Well, there's some other flood zones you can't put it in, but we don't have those type of flood zones in Ascension Parish. But we can put them in A, E, and X. So A, A, E, and X. So we're good. They agreed to do that. And when the that FEMA inspector for your claim, because I've questioned them, and like Parish President said, they can't say how long it takes to get your trailer. So they never did answer that, danced around that a good bit. So I just asked them, what's the process? Give me the cliff notes. And the cliff notes are, when that FEMA inspector that came out looked at your house to quantify your claim, and he puts his report in, then somebody's going to contact you. He said 5 to 10 days. So you could probably recommend probably be closer to 10 days because they're very inundated. That's why they brought in so many inspectors into Ascension. And that, so in 10 days, when they contact you, and if you want housing, you tell them then you want housing. You want a trailer. I don't know what the end result is because I hadn't found anybody that's reached that pinnacle yet, okay? So when they put that in, they have one bedroom, two bedrooms. But these are not the travel trailers. They're full mobile home, and they don't fit in a lot of places. And they have a 200 amp main. So, and FEMA will contract somebody to put a temporary pole down and all that. When that's going to be part of their package. So I don't have anybody yet I can put my hands on and talk to that actually went through it and got the trail. So we'll continue to work at that and see how that goes for people. On the state side, they had the DSNAP program to go get some money for food. I've heard of a host of people that qualified, another host of people that didn't qualify. I think anything that you don't qualify, I think there's an appeal process for almost anything for FEMA, there's an appeal process. It takes sitting down, takes a long time, and it gets quite aggravated, okay? So we'll try to help anybody that can, but on the DSNAP program, so that's there. And they also have the, it's federally based, but it's the state doing it, the shelter in place program, shelter at home, rather. I don't want to use the wrong words. And that's up to $15,000. So I'm asking people, if you need some help, go ahead and apply for that. That takes time. I'm sure that's another aggravating line with some long questions and things like that. Go ahead and apply for that, because that goal is to get somebody back into their home, get a bedroom working, bathroom working, kitchen working, get the home where you can kind of stay in it while you're working on it. Some homes are eligible for that. Some are not. So that's the programs that are out there, and we're working just like everybody else to try to find it. Where's the edges of all this stuff? You know, just when they put these bulletins out and say they got a program, you know, that looks good and it sounds good, okay? Well, we did work with them on the on permanent housing, or if, you know, if you want to go out and get a mobile home, a modular house, or you want to build a house right now, is this based on our regulations? As Kenny had said, that, you know, we have a wording in there that says that we're going to go a foot above record inundation. Well, that's been waived tonight through executive order, and we're going to take a look at that. But what FEMA did is they went back to their old rules back on Katrina, and they pulled them up. So for the individual housing, for the trailers that they're going to put there, it's going to be the maximum blocking will be about 44 inches. that's, you know, the safe height, and, you know, people that fool with that, they know you come up with single block when you reach a certain height, you got double blocks, cross section, and all that. There's a good diagram for that. So if you do get a FEMA-assisted, you know, MHU modular housing unit, it's not going to be 8 feet off the ground, okay? All right? So, you know, the people that's going to be out of their home for a long time, please, you know, if you want that and you need that, put that application in when you're contacted and try to get that if you're going to be out of your house for a long time.
Councilman.
Yes, sir.
In some of the meetings that we've been in with FEMA, if your home flooded and you filed an FEMA application, you should file an SBA for an SBA loan. You don't have to take the loan, but you may need, if you need to subsequently, if you wait, you will not be able to file that. So if you filed the FEMA application because you've had some flood damage, go ahead and file the flood SBA loan application. And if your business is flooded, file the SBA business application, because the rates are anywhere from what I've heard, 1.5% to 3%. But you may get, when FEMA comes out and evaluates your home, they may give you a little grant money, but they may say, based on your income, you can do an SBA loan and you need to borrow some money to do the rest. And that'll be up to you whether you want to do it, but it's important that you apply now before that time period passes.
And that was the next one on my list, was the SBA, and thank you for getting probably a better explanation than I could, but the SBA, go ahead and apply for that. You know, even if you got insurance, you take the insurance money, you take whatever they're giving you off the $33,000, whatever they're going to give you, then go for a low interest loan, and you can try to find yourself in, you know, back home, you know. So I do know I talked to a renter today that of course doesn't own the house that we're in, so that, you know, the person they're renting from does not have the responsibility to put them back in the house. He or she owns those facilities, and they're gonna take whatever time they got to get it back as quick as they can. But for FEMA assistance, there was it's just kind of led to go ahead and apply for the SBA for some kind of low interest loan, and even if she's turned down, then that would qualify her to go right back to FEMA for some more assistance. So, you know, it's a little play on words there, but it's something that we're all figuring out. And I just ask anybody got any kind of problem, you run into a roadblock, give us a holler. And we're going to try to do whatever we can for you.
Now, the governor told us at the conference that number's lingering out there, $33,000. He said himself, he didn't know anybody that got $33,000.
Right. Well,
and the average is about 5 to 7, I think.
Up to 33.
Even if you lost everything, it's kind of crazy. They can't tell you what the formula is. So
anyway, whatever rules they came in when they first marched in with the book, the staff, our plan zone department, all our inspection department, everybody jumped on it, and everybody took a look at it, and all the council members, and tried to take a look at it, and they, what can we do? Which, you know, the first rule, first thing they said, it's not feasible for areas, so they work with them to change it. So we're going to continue to work with them to serve the people. Ms. Kazzo.
Yes, Mr. President, if you don't mind, would it be possible for Mr. Rue, if he does not mind, to give us an update on the progress on the ridge, on the Alligator Bayou Road? This is an opportunity for people in a wider audience to hear what's happening there and what work is being done to help them, as they are feeling awfully beleaguered.
Yeah, thank good you. Thing is, it is coming down real slow because of the situation in Bayou Manchac itself and Bayou Fountain. Everything's holding, it's being held up at this location of where our locks and where our cuts are and where at present the pumps are. The pumps will be cutting off tomorrow morning at 7 o'clock and moving out. They should take about a day and a half to get the pumps out. We will be mobilizing Sunday to do another cut at just about the location of where the pumps are now. With our cut that's going there, we can get more water out more efficiently and get it to a lower elevation faster. So we will be doing that Sunday. But again, the water level is coming down. And Bridge Road itself, there's a few locations, Clown Peter, a couple locations toward the back of Ridge Road that's still inundated. Forest Road, but the people are being able to function somewhat now. They're cleaning up the places, they're able to get some of the damaged material out of their houses. And again, it's getting where they can do some cleanup. I expect when in the next couple of days, especially, or say the first of next week, after we make this this other cut, we should see a fairly rapid decline in elevation. Now, it's really, really important that we continue this, because any rain in that basin, even an insignificant rainstorm, can impact these people. It'll build it back up to the elevation that it was several days ago. So we are going to do this and do whatever's necessary to get it down to a normal elevation of about 4. Right now, we did a what I call a regression. We did a predictive forecast on it. If it stays at the same level of decline, elevation decline right now, you're looking at probably another 30 days to get it completely down to a 2 or 3, a normal elevation with no more rainfall. I'm hoping that will increase, the decline will increase once we get this other cut in. And the fact that that water level becomes, you know, lower in that basin, you're actually dealing with less water, because of the slope is coming down to this point here. So you're actually having to get less water out, so the water should, the elevation can start dropping exponentially as the elevation drops. So I'm hoping that in 2 weeks, rather than 4 weeks, that we'll get down to a manageable level. At the same time, too, we're working with Iberville Parish, and we're looking at formulating some plans of protecting that area in the future. And we're going to be coming back to the Drainage Board and to the Council with these plans probably within the next 30 days.
Bill, I appreciate that. I want to thank you. And I want to mention to you that, so that the public knows, I have been told by more than one engineer that what you did on that, on Alligator Bayou Road, what you thought about in the shower that morning, was innovative. And truly a remarkable way to make a difference for those folks back there, beyond what anybody had thought of to do before. So I'm grateful on behalf of those folks who still don't feel like it got out fast enough, and I understand that. And I deeply regret that it can't move faster. But I'm very grateful to you for what you did, for the innovative thought that you had. Stay in the shower if you need to. And you know, come up with some more that will help us, together with engineers, to figure out how to make a real difference going forward, not only in what happens there, but in our region. I think, as the parish president mentioned earlier, we've got to have a region. This is clear demonstration that we need a regional flood management plan. And if our local leadership, certainly we can, and if our state delegation and our federal delegation will help us, we can make a difference in our parish and in our region. But today, you're my hero in this, and I thank you for that.
Well, besides that, when you mentioned about the regional plan, we have met with the Pontchartrain Levee District, and that's where a lot of the information going to Cassidy and to Graves is through the PLD on a regional issue, which includes all of our drainage, major drainage plans that it's in the works right now. In addition to that, we're actively looking at the changing some of our drainage projects that's in the works to elevate them to a little bit higher level, including going for a full certification of our levee system, which means a full closure of this system at a higher level. So we are looking at all of this right now, and seeing the trying to determine, number one, what kind of issues will be presented for changing our permit, but more closely, you know, trying to determine the cost, total cost. But I think it's the right time to do it because of Congress getting involved and trying to get some federal money in to change some of the things, some of the projects that we already have on board, in progress, and getting the Corps not to hold us up too much just for changing the elevation of some of our levees and some of our structures. So it's a good time to do it, and we're going forward with that.
Can I ask one more question? There is one of the things that is most difficult in my district right now is traffic. Mm-hmm. And while we are patient and we're talking a lot about all the opportunity we have to host our Gator friends and how much we love them, it's hard to move around, particularly in the at those four times of the mm-hmm. day that school is taking in and out. So Highway 70, 428, Bluff Road being closed is a major detriment to mm-hmm. our movement. Do you anticipate that falling? When do you anticipate that falling? And I've had folks express to me their concern that that culvert and that mm-hmm. road has sat in water for mm-hmm. an awfully long time mm-hmm. and that we're going to need, and we are, I want you to assure the folks mm-hmm. that you're going to, we're going to know about the integrity of that roadway and its base there before we allow them to drive on it.
Right. Well, I took a measurement actually today on the low side of that curve in the inundated part of Bluff Road. There's about 10 inches left to go at the low part. The high part is already out of water, and it's really passable, but it's not for the public because of safety issues with the state. And I anticipate, especially with the cut that we're going to put in Sunday, the fact it's a holiday on Monday, I'm hoping Tuesday that it will be opened up for the public for that. We are doing an assessment of all our infrastructure, bridges and highways. We already started the bridges with the DOTD on Off System Bridge Program, and we're getting ready to get started with the highway portion of it. We know of areas right now that needs some kind of maintenance on it to get it to a standard that we would say would be safe, and we'll be identifying that. The other thing is the fact that we're going at the next council meeting, I think, we're going to try to go forward with the approval to go with the contract for our paving, yearly paving contract, where it's not a specific project, but it'd be throughout the year. We had discussed it already. We're going to try to get that in place at the next council meeting, get it passed so we can go ahead forward with this. And the first thing on that contract, annual contract, retainer contract, will be to going through and fixing some of the roads that we identified is in need of repair due to this incident. And that'll be the first thing on that contract is to take care of this kind of stuff.
Thank you. Well, to you and your people at DPW, we owe you a debt of gratitude. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wolf. Any other questions? The council members. We'll move on to agenda item number 7. I've asked our assessor, Mr. Merchant Smiley, to come in, give us an update on the parish assessment changes, you know, because based on the regulations and the laws, and Merchant, appreciate you coming, taking this opportunity to come.
Thank you. I appreciate
it. Pass it out to us, man.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I'd like to thank you, the parish council, and, of course, the parish president for inviting me. Although I think it's a little premature because I will explain to you what the assessor's office has done to this point. I do want to say this. Never before has the heart and character and inspiration of the citizens of Ascension Parish has been as evident as they have been during this catastrophic flood. A special thank to all the elected officials, first responders, church groups, volunteers who helped make us through the first phase of this tragedy. Shortly after the disaster, the tax commission sent us a letter. I have y'all a copy of the letter sent by the tax commission. As soon as we evaluated the letter, we actually emailed all the elected officials, or I should say the ones that are affected by ad valorem tax. We actually emailed them a copy of what we were basically going to do and had to do according to law. In response, I had to think of some way to do this as quickly as possible. We actually have 6 months to do the reassessment of the flood damaged property, but 6 months is entirely too long. I wanted to be able to finish this job before the end of this tax year so that we can make sure that we have revenue coming into government for the rest of the year. And so what I did is I had a three-phase program that we are going to do. The first phase consisted of field inspections. I would really like to thank the staff at the assessor's office because they volunteered to work Saturday and Sunday after the flood to go out and do these assessments. And I was very pleased with the work that they did, so I'd like to thank them personally. We sent teams out in the field, and I was thinking that that was going to be probably about a two-week project, but we completed it in actually 1 week. So I was very proud of my team for doing that. Phase two deals with, once you had that information, we actually have to take it and enter it into our camera system. That's a system that we have that takes all the information and makes it very easy to understand for us, and it actually generates reports that I can get to y'all at a certain time. And so we are doing that during step two. And we should be finished with step two, I would say, within the next week, week and a half at the most. So I'm very, very satisfied with the progress that we're making there. And lastly is phase three. It deals with the actual reassessment of the flood damaged properties in our system. Well, Louisiana law actually requires us to take into account all damages, obsolescence, and depreciation caused by the flood. And like I said earlier, we do have up to 6 months to do it, but I think it's imperative that we do it before the end of the year. And I'd like to make sure that the sheriff has our information so that they can send out the tax bills before the end of this year. In the near future, probably within the next 3 weeks or 2 weeks, we are going to publish all the names on our website. Our website is www.ascensionassessor.com. And if the citizens of Ascension Parish do not see the ones that had flood damage, if they do not see their name and address on this list, I'd like them to contact our office at 225-647-8182, or they can email us at flood@ascensionassessor.com. Like I said earlier, I'm real proud of our crew. We are going to have this information very shortly. Just to give you a heads up, some of our assessor's office hadn't even started this project. And we will have this done very, very quickly. And as soon as we do, we're going to contact the elected officials, the parish-wide elected officials, and the council, and let y'all know exactly what it will cost to do what we're doing.
Real quick question for you, Mert. Appreciate the three-phase. That looks like that covers it. But the actual reassessment, is there any... is the interaction with the landowner, the homeowner, or something, or is it based on what you're seeing to do the reassessment?
Right, we're developing the exact plan. Do I have the exact plan now? I certainly don't have it, but we are developing, and of course it has something to do with the degree of the severity of the flooding. And we're just going to treat everybody fair as we possibly can.
Yeah.
These people in Ascension Parish are suffering right now, mm-hmm. and we need to do whatever we can to help them and make sure that at least we can help them somewhat.
Yeah, that's what I just want
sure,
to know. How
sure.
How is it going to be evaluated? And,
sure. I'll have some imperial numbers for you very shortly.
Well, one question is... it's going to happen this year for maybe a reduction in tax rate.
That is correct.
Is it being their house depreciated, would that continue in the following years?
Well,
their house has flooded, it did depreciate in
that's correct.
Value because they're not going to be able to sell it like what they could have. And some homes almost flooded, almost got in. Is
sure.
that going to be affected also?
Well, what we're doing now is we're concentrating on the ones that actually had damage. Because if it came in your yard, it really didn't depreciate. Because to be frank with you, we have all the rural properties right now assessed at a very, very low amount right now. Should be a lot higher, but we wanted to treat people right, and that's what we're doing. But what we got to do is we have to look at what the market does next year, what the housing market does next year, because that influences what we do in our office. We have several factors that we have to look at, but that influences that. So we... looking at what happened in New Orleans and what happened in other places throughout Louisiana, we found out that because they had so few houses available, that these houses came back up quickly. They came back up quickly to their normal price. And man, if you didn't flood, your prices, your property value went up considerably. But we're going to be fair. We're going to do what the market says that we need to do, because that's a major factor on how we do our business.
Thank you, sir. Any other questions for the assessor? Yes, Mr. Sadler.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Merrick, for such a fine job. I have a wild question. I'm not quite sure how to ask it, but let's say I'm a senior citizen and I have a reverse mortgage on my home, and as a result, it's all equity and you're getting a check as opposed to you paying a check. What's going to happen to those people? They still going to get checks for a property that's worth a heck of a lot more now that it's flooded? And maybe that's not something you can answer. And what are the tax consequences the same, if any?
That is nothing that we use in our computations. We do not use that whatsoever in our computations of a person's property.
Well, someone would have to be on the hook for the fact that you're going to devaluate the property. Rightfully so, because it's
I'm not going to devaluate it. The market will devaluate
it. Right, that's right. Yes. Let me rephrase it. Yeah. It'll be worth less, point B.
Correct, yes.
And as a result, do these people just keep getting their regular size checks, or somebody's got to be on the hook for this?
That is certainly a question that I can't answer at this time.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
And I would if I could.
I got it as a constituent question. I didn't know how to answer it, so I said, well,
I could do some research on that and get with you. I'd be glad to do that.
If you don't mind, that'd be
sure.
Fine.
No, I'd be glad to.
Thank you,
be
sir.
Glad to.
And, Merck, I think the same thing would happen to somebody else that has a home, and they felt like they had $40,000 worth of equity for equity loan, and the equity loan post-event may go down.
That's correct.
Value
that's correct.
Of equity.
Yeah, we just, we don't get involved in the loan situations and all. Right. We just get involved in the actual value of the property, and that's our job.
So good, Merch. So you gave us I'm going to try to ask the guys on 21 possibly,
yes.
Post this, and they may get with your office and get with you to get some type of bulletin to post it on Channel 21.
I would really appreciate that. I was going to ask y'all if we could do that.
To get information
yes.
out, but
yes.
The phone number is really good because yes. a lot of people, they're out of the computer world right now.
That's
for
true.
A little while,
that's true.
Anyway.
But no, we are making passes not just that one time. We're going to go out in the field and talk to people and help answer questions that they may have. And we're going to do that. We're going to be out in the field regular doing that, because I think it's the correct thing to do.
Yeah, there's no doubt that this event's going to change the landscape.
Yeah, it certainly will.
Santa Mar and Lake. And
But it will bounce there. Back. Believe me, it will bounce back.
No, I know it's going to come back. I'm going to be one of them.
Yes. I wish you a speedy recovery, too.
Any other questions for Assessor Smiley? Thank you, Mark.
Appreciate Thank you all very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
With that, we'll move into agenda item number 8, authorization of purchase of People's Water Company of Donaldsonville. Utility Chairman Johnson, you want to open on that, and then we give it to our legal counsel, sir.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. We've entered into an agreement for purchase of People's. We had negotiations, rather, when we came up with what we believe to be an offer that we were considering. Since then, they've had some issues at People's Water that we were familiar with, caused us some concern. We got our legal counsel to look at the agreement, go through it, and make sure that we're properly protected from any kind of legal issues going forward that might arise, where we're not going to be held responsible for anything prior to us owning the system. So with that, we'd like our legal team to go ahead and kind of brief us on the changes and things that we come up with.
Yes, Mr. Jeff Diaz.
And I have Trey Jones with
me. Tim Hardy.
And Tim Hardy.
Yes.
Yeah. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you all for having us. If I come to one more meeting this year, I want a name tag like O'Neill Parent.
You have to take
to carry one over here across the river with me.
You'd have to take a cut and pay, sir.
I'll take it. To get that name tag, I'll take it. Thanks for recognizing my dad, too. Really appreciate that. We've been working on this for a while, actually since last, it's been worked on for a long time, but we have a purchase agreement. dated last November. Of course, we had this water event occurred in March, and everything now is the same as it was in October, except for the water event, which actually improved the system to a large extent because they were required to do some modifications and capital improvements. And we also now have 5 months under our belt. That water event was in March 25th, and here we are September 1st, and we've had no more water events, emergency declarations. The emergency declaration has been pulled down. They have the same number of customers, and we have 5 months of a good track record. And DHH has recently issued a letter to us saying that we would have no liability for what happened then. We would only be liable going forward for what we do, but they also don't anticipate doing anything further with what they know. If they find something different, of course, they will. What you're buying here, folks, in case you, I don't know if y'all were all on this deal when this was constructed, this purchase agreement, but you're buying 3 pieces of property. You're buying a lot of equipment. I mean, pages and pages and pages of equipment. You're buying 6 vehicles, and you're buying 3,600 customers, 3,600 customers. You're buying the accounts receivable. You're buying the deposits. You're buying the billing. We met with staff this week to make sure everybody's on board in case you would vote tonight. We don't want to get caught because we have to close by the 22nd. So time is closing in on us quick. We met with staff, IT, finance, operations, billing, and personnel, and all four this week said that they were ready to go. Of course, you still have some things, loose ends you got to tie up. There were some questions about their employees. We're taking on their employees for 6 months, but they become our employees, and they are subject to termination for cause day one. You're taking them on for 6 months, only as kind of a, hey, guys, we'll give you a six-month deal, but as our employee, I don't give you a license to violate all the parish rules. You become a parish employee subject to our rules, so you could terminate on day two. We've also included an agreement if something would happen to one of those employees as a result of the war event last March, on day one, that something official would happen to that employee, we could terminate based on that. So we don't know, there's so much rumor and rhetoric about what happened, but the fact of the matter is that happened in March, and they're still operating. There's no more emergency. We don't know really what happened. I'm not the water quality guy. I got them with me. Yeah. I just handled the transaction part of it. As far as the transaction, if you guys bless it tonight, which would be the purchase of the 3 tracts of the movable property, as well as the servitudes, then I'm ready to go and ready to close. If you have water quality issues and DHH issues, the two guys, the cavalry behind me is ready to step up.
Yeah, I think Benny would like Tim Hardy.
Yeah, Mr. Hardy, if you could kind of explain what y'all have done since y'all come on board looking at this for us, please.
Absolutely. My name is Tim Hardy. I'm outside counsel for the parish. I'm a partner in the firm of Rodell Parsons. I have with me Trey Jones is also my partner. My charge to the parish was simply to make sure that if this transaction were to take place, that the parish would be protected. In my years, I have seen transactions occur, and the due diligence was simply not enough, that an innocent party inherited problems that somebody else had. It's been well publicized that there have been issues associated with this company in the view of DHH. The good news is we asked for, desired, went back and forth for a while with counsel for Peoples and with Mr. Diaz, and we actually got a correspondence from DHH that in my view is rare. What this document says, and it's signed off by someone with signatory authority, by DHH, chief engineer, and it says in effect, without my reading it, is that first of all, that Peoples is now in compliance. Peoples is in compliance. In addition to that, they're expecting no penalties to flow as a result of any violation of the previous administrative order. Not many agencies tell you that, but that's in this letter. They go further. They also say that there's no expectation of any penalties that will be imposed on the parish, as Mr. Diaz just said, unless there's something that occurs under the watch of the parish itself. And clearly the parish is maintained. They're totally, wholly unaffiliated with Peoples at this time. So they have put in writing that post-acquisition, there will be no penalties associated or levied against the parish for anything that happened while Peoples owned it. They went even further because in talking to the administration, in terms of using something for disinfection purposes, there are costs associated, and to the benefit of the parish, the use of chlorine dioxide. And it's our understanding that at this point, Peoples is prohibited from using chlorine dioxide. We have a signed letter here from the state, from the agency, from DHH, saying that there's nothing to preclude the parish from requesting the authority to actually use that same disinfectant again, not saying what the decision is going to be, but saying they're going to judge that fairly as though the request made from day one without any of this previous history. I didn't know this letter would be given, but it is. And what my partner's role was to go through the entire transaction and make sure there was nothing inconsistent in the transaction with this letter we received from DHH. So, I mean, I've been around a while. This is, as a councilwoman advised, we got to make sure we keep up with this.
So, councilman, come on up. You're coming up. Basically, we're whole harmless.
Yes, sir. What we're going to do is we have this letter from the Department of Health, which is important.
Make sure.
But when we have the contract documents, we want to be extra sure, and we're protecting the parish the best we can.
Yep.
Mr. Diaz has done a good job on that. We did just receive the documents the day before yesterday, so we'll make sure that they're solid before the closing, and that we're not buying any of the liability. We're also going to make doubly sure, like Mr. Diaz said, that for any employee issues that we may have over the 6 months, that we're in a good spot where we can take care of the situations as they come up.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So to kind of go back, give a brief history on the reason we started down this road was currently we are purchasing water from Ascension and St. James Parishes, and with the recent issues with the brain-eating amoebas and what it's costing us, additional costs, because they can't raise their treatment levels up high enough to ensure that on our tail ends of our lines that we are above the required treatment levels. We're having to purchase additional chemical injection points and inject chemicals, which is also causing us to flush more water than what we previously were doing. And so basically with acquiring this, it puts us in a lot better control of our own destiny to produce our own water at a cheaper cost, reduce our chemical cost off as far as treatment, and make sure we have a better reliable system not only to the citizens of ACUD1, right, but also within the city of Donaldsonville by merging these two systems together and making improvements as we go forward. It also has a lot of capacity in the plant that's not currently being utilized, which gives us a lot of options to expand that system not only to further areas of the West Bank, but also to potentially some of the East Bank if we decide to go that route and bore underneath the river and run a line to the East Bank. So it's got a lot of potential for us, and most of it is on the upside. There are some issues in some areas with some of the treatment lines, but I feel in my understanding of the system that we have. Point to where there's a lot of upside to it and a lot of realization of things that will bring us to the point and make the system more efficient and even more valuable to us in the future.
Thank you, sir. Yes, Councilman.
I don't know if I'm going to you. I might go to administration on this. With the 3,600 customers we have, what kind of expenditures are we going to have to get this system upgraded, and are we acquiring any debt that they have now?
We're not acquiring any.
No debt? Okay. I know 3,600 customers at what user fee monthly? Is it going to go up to match ACUD's?
Mr. Dawson.
Fee? Yeah, my name is Ken.
We've been working on this for what, a year, year and
yeah,
a half?
Yeah, year, year and a half, I think. And
kind of explain the fees.
I spent a little bit about it. We actually went through all the cost data before there was a decision for the council to proceed forward, so I'll just kind of try to give a high-level view. I don't have those numbers in front of me right now. But we are increasing the cost a bit. The Donaldsville customer will be paying the same water cost that ACUD number one is paying. I think the percentage increase was about 30%, something around that nature. So that will bring everybody on the same even keel. That's also with a plan to address any of the improvements that need to happen. And we work with Tommy Lejeune, who was with our accounting firm that worked with the parish, who went through detailed financial evaluations, and basically just puts the parish in a good place to not to have to continue to supplement payment of a bond and have a negative, but get to a positive. And also there were some discussions of how we move forward at a pace and take care of those quadrants that would need improvements to the system, you know, as we move forward. So, I mean, I could send those numbers out again, but we did go through that.
Average user fee, that's where you come up with that?
The number, I don't remember exactly what that number is.
The number would be around about $34, $35 average.
Yeah, about 30, yeah, I think, Councilman.
Mr. Chairman, real quick, Todd, if you don't mind.
Sure.
Ken, while you're up there, we talked about also a transition management team going into this thing. Can you explain what our plans are as far as doing, you know, bringing in someone to help us transition, taking over ownership, and making sure all the policies and procedures are in place to where we can continue to operate at a high quality level?
Sure, I'd be glad to. You know, one thing that we wanted to do is as we move into a new system to ensure that we were keeping an eye on the operations and what was happening to make sure that we felt comfortable that everything was being done at a level that we wouldn't have any issues. First thing we're going to do is the same company that assisted us with this incredible amoeba situation, that had several meetings with President Matassa and I with St. James, that have vast knowledge, will be assisting us in going through operational procedures, going through process flow charts for every piece of equipment, so that will be an understanding of what goes in a piece of equipment, what comes out, what the expectation of treatment level after you exit that particular point. The second thing we're going to do is that we already have basically a person with our parish administration that looks at everything that DHH requires to be reported. We have a person on staff, because we have a water system, and we are actually reporting things to DHH now. That person is going to look at every reportable requirement for the current company, and then we're going to also allow that particular person to look at, we don't have a treatment plant, but look at every reportable requirement for the treatment plant and make sure that we are reporting them timely and that we're on top of it. Third thing we will do, there will be blind testing that we will perform. There will be times when testing is performed by people's water. We will duplicate those tests to come to a level of comfort that they are being performed correctly and that we feel very good that the staff there is performing up to our level of expectations. So we are on it. Mr. Bill DePue has written some things in place as utility director, and the staff is very excited about putting the expertise to make sure that we have what we need.
One more question, Mr. Ken.
Yes, sir.
I know the facility is up to par and it's got over capacity, but what I'm understanding, the infrastructure has quite a bit of problems as far as leaks and piping that we're going to have to replace. Do we know how much of that, and do we know the cost of what that is going to be?
I don't think that we know the exact number, Councilman, of exactly what that cost is going to be, but I think that in our initial financial evaluations, there was some number that we decided we were going to put toward that particular effort, and we were only going to put a certain amount per year. I don't want to go off the top of my head with the danger of quoting the numbers.
If you could send all that.
I'll send it all to you, but that was considered, and we are going to move forward with improvement, you know, on a year-to-year basis.
One thing I want to say about the cost of the water, and Councilman Joseph knows this, Peoples hadn't done a rate increase in a long time. They were going to Public Service Commission with a 50% increase. So 30% is a lot less.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Mr. Saddle.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank all of you guys, and thank you, Mr. President. Thank you, Ken. I just want to be sure I've captured all this correctly, because I thought maybe that there were, and it was called a emergency event, which has been pulled back on March 25th. I thought there was actually, in between there and us giving the extensions and serving with Benny on the Utilities Committee, that there were actually two events. And I'm looking at some newspaper clippings, one at 4/28, the other on 5/24. Is that just a misspeak, or not that it makes a lot of difference? Because what I'm also hearing now, you're telling me we don't have the same amount of customers, but in the interim, they have fixed this. I want to be sure this is all on the record. It's a situation now where we actually have improved some things. The pipes that Mr. Lambert's talking about now, notwithstanding, we're buying these three pieces of property. I do have a question about that, exactly who we're buying that from. Tons of equipment, the 3,600. And we even have the 3,600 customers, the DHH stamp of approval as a bonus. So everything looks fine, and you may have already answered it too. My other question was going to be, are we ready at the parish level to take this over? And I think you're answering, Ken, put you on a record again with a resounding yes, we can do this, and everything's going to be fine. And then the last and final question was about the rates. So that everybody understands, the Public Service Commission is not going to be able to deal with this. It's strictly going to be now up to the parish to say this is how much you pay. And I think you've answered on that was another one of my questions, that D-bill is not going to be charged anymore, but some other customers, I'm not sure if I understand who exactly, are going to be charged about 30% more.
No, the Donceville customers will be paying the same rate that the ACUD number one customers will be paying, which is
One more question, too. Is it still $5.9 million?
I think that's the number.
And to be comfortable, as a councilman about to vote on this, we know that's a good price because?
Well, because we did the financial evaluation, going through having Tom Lejeune here with us and taking weeks.
How much do we think it's worth? I mean, how much of a good deal are we getting here?
Well, I mean, we started out with $11.2 million asking price, and we got down to $5.9 million asking price, so after about a year of negotiation. So
we thought at one time that we could get it at $5 million, and then, back with previous president, and it bumped up to, I think, what, $900,000 to $5.9 million. That is the figure. Who exactly are we buying this from, or is it because it – I've read the package, obviously, but we have three pieces of property involved and lots of equipment. It seems like there's all kinds of owners here that are going to get – how's that going to work? Multiple checks? Are we paying something to some group?
No, it's just one firm. Water Treatment and Controls Company, doing business as People's Water Company of Donaldsonville.
Okay.
And there was a number of mergers back in
– And with that one check for 5.9, we get everything that you listed.
We get all this stuff.
All that stuff, right.
I'll be happy to share it with
you. Oh, no. I've looked at it in the packet, trust me.
I even have titles.
I think it's an underestimate to say it's a ton of equipment. I just hope we can manage it and we get the pipe thing fixed. We're doing the right thing here. I was led to believe, and I hope that hasn't changed, that we could actually maybe one day make a little bit off of this. I'd heard talk about what was it, Ken, a pipe underneath the Mississippi River maybe and supplying other areas.
Yeah,
is that still something being contemplated?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's contemplated because you have extra capacity, generating capacity from the plant. And keep in mind, you're still looking at maybe a pretty large industrial area that you have in Donaldsonville that's going to need water and things of that issue. So having the plant with extra capacity to use is something that is very valuable. On the question you asked about whether we're able to take it over, and I want the council to understand, we are not just kicking everybody from People's Water out of the door and we're walking in with our people to do it. I mean, we have people that have operated this plant for a long time that have demonstrated the willingness to want to stay on board, and those that do a good job and continue to do so, we want them to become a part of the Ascension Parish family. And so, as I think Mr. Hardy said, I mean, they have done a good job of producing water. People in Donaldsonville are still drinking water, and they're still utilizing water, and they haven't had any issues. Also, as Mr. Hardy said, or I think it was Mr. Diaz, that because of this, there have been several improvements to the plant. I think it was some flow transmitters, some feed equipment, that even we get more than what we initially looked for when we first did our assessment and evaluation. So we do feel very comfortable that time.
Okay, and you brought up another issue. I heard we can terminate on essentially day two, I believe was the language used, any employee because they become our employee. But I don't think we have any intention to do that. Sure. I mean, that sounds like a positive thing, and you'd want that power. I mean, I'm on our side of it.
Sure.
But have we done any due diligence? Are any employees right now that it may have caused these boil advisory problems, or is it was just strictly some other uncontrollable events? I mean, we're not going to have a whole bunch of problems with a bunch of employees that need to go, are we?
No, but if we were to find that out on day two, that those employees would be terminated. That's all we could ask.
We don't know it, but if there's a problem there,
that's
and we're probably, correct me if I'm wrong, limited to how much we can really look into that.
That's a good answer, and that's the answer we'll give you.
I didn't mean to answer my question. I'm just, I'm asking you.
Answer that question.
Okay.
With that answer. No, there's certain things they're not willing to share because they actually disagree that what's been alleged happened as it's alleged to have happened.
Okay.
And they don't want to pin the blame on any employee because then they would be blaming somebody for
maybe something that really didn't happen. So their position was, if something is found by DHH or some investigatory crew that an employee did something wrong, you could terminate. And by the way, we're bringing these employees on at 0 years of experience, 0 years of service. Some of these folks have been there 20 years, but in the contract, they're coming on with us at zero. So, I mean, nobody's getting a golden parachute here. Nobody's getting a golden door on the way out. You come in as a parish employee, subject to our rules and regulations.
Let me just ask something.
Ken, are we going to be hiring a lot of people, by the way, inside the parish to run this too? Or
No, we just, right now, all the people that we bring in, the people that are currently employed, the
at
people
tables.
For, yes.
Okay.
And one thing that I want to say this because Councilman Johnson kind of stressed this in our initial conversation. We're not looking at getting rid of people from people's water for no cause. But if there's ever a situation where we feel through our assessment, our evaluation, that someone is doing anything that is causing a degradation in the quality of treatment or could cause an issue with the public, they will not be working for Ascension Parish. And I think that's President Metasta's position, not only for people's water, but for anyone doing any work for Ascension Parish, that's the position that the parish takes. So we feel very comfortable that we'll be able to move forward and put the parish in a good financial position.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Any other comments? Yes, Mr. Bill Dawson.
I just had a couple of questions. You talked about, I don't know if this is to Tim or Jeff or whom, but I heard some answers about liability as far as DHH. But what about liability, personal injury lawsuits, or, you know, can you talk about that some? Somebody?
There will be none on the parish. There's a pending class action involving Peoples. They're adequately insured for it. They're giving us an indemnification agreement, whole homeless. We will have no exposure for the pending cases.
Okay.
All thank related you. To that event.
Okay.
We have, what, like $16 million insurance?
So there's actually more than that.
It's not
ours. Okay.
Could y'all say that louder for the record? I'm not sure that was recorded. Well, I think what President Metasta says is very important.
There's adequate liability insurance.
But he gave a number. What did I hear?
They've submitted to the court. Oh, it's over $15 million.
Over $15
million? Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. So I guess this is to Ken. If you did an economic evaluation, I assume, and what's the payback on the $5.9 million?
Okay, I would have to look at it. I hadn't looked at it in a while, Councilman. I would get back with you. I didn't think to bring that. In fact, I got to give it to Mr. DePue. He asked that probably would bring it tonight, but I would get that information. I don't want to quote anything that's not accurate, but we can give you those numbers.
Okay, thank you.
Any further questions? At this time, the chair would entertain a motion.
I make a motion that we accept.
A motion by Mr. Oliver Joseph. Second by Mr. Benny Johnson. Madam Secretary, please note that Councilman Turner wishes to abstain from this voting on the subject. Any opposition? Motion passes. We move on to agenda item number 9, public hearing ordinance, reading of ordinance to amend the Ascension Parish zoning map from mixed use 2, MU2, to small planned unit development SPUD, zoning review ID PZ-1017-16, lot B1 of Cloverdale Subdivision for Brookwood Properties LLC, Cube Smart Storage located on the west side of LA Highway 73, approximately 1,500 feet north of Southwood Village Avenue.
Okay.
Mr. Parrington.
This ordinance amends the official zoning designation of lot B1 of Cloverdale Subdivision for Mixed Use 2 to Small Plan Unit Development. This rezone is identified as zoning review ID PZ-101716, lot B1 of Cloverdale Subdivision of Brookwood Properties LLC, Residential Parish Local Government Subdivision defined by Article 6, Section 44, Louisiana Constitution, 1974, whereas the parish of Ascension is the governing responsible body of the zoning regulations within the jurisdiction, whereas Article 6 of the Home Rule Charter of Ascension Parish adopted May 4, 1993, identifies the process of manning to adopt ordinances regulating the lands of the parish, whereas the official zoning map of Ascension Parish was last adopted March 8, 2016, whereas the parish council reserves the right to make changes to the official zoning map by ordinance. This request has been processed in compliance with procedures set forth, be it ordained by the Central Parish Governing Authority, the official zoning map of Central Parish, Louisiana, is amended to reflect property identified as Exhibit A as a small plan unit development as the official zoning designation. In the event any portion of the ordinance ever held invalid or unconstitutional by any, for any reason, by any court of competent jurisdiction over it, such portion shall be deemed separate, distinct, and independent provision, should not affect the validity of any portions of the ordinance. The effective date of this ordinance shall be in full effect as submitted by law. The exhibits are the legal description, the black map, the aerial zoning map, the development plan, the development agreement. This ordinance has been submitted to a vote. The vote thereon was as follows.
Chair, we entertain a motion.
Open a public hearing.
Motion to open public hearing by Mr. Sadler, second by Mr. Cazzo.
Motion to close.
Motion to close by Mr. Sadler.
Second.
Second by Mr. Cagliotta. Chair, would entertain a motion.
Motion to move.
We have a motion by Ms. Cazzo, second by Mr. Cagliotta. Any objection? Any discussion?
A discussion.
Yes, Mr. Sadler.
I don't object, Mr. Chairman. As far as discussion, I just want for the record, I think I know this. I want to be sure since it's in my district. This particular rezoning was unanimously recommended by our zoning commission. Is that correct, Mr. Fournier?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Any further comment? Any objection? Motion passes. We'll move on to agenda item number 12, reading of ordinance to amend the Central Parish zoning map from mixed use 2 MU2 to small planned unit development SPUD zoning review ID PZ 1029-16, tract A-1, A-2, and A-3 of the subdivision tract A into A-1, A-2, and A-3 for Industrial Design Incorporated, located on the west side of LA Highway 73, approximately 1,200 feet north of LA Highway 6201. Mr. Barrington.
This ordinance amends the official zoning designation of tract A-1, A-2, and A-3 for mixed use to plan small plan unit development. This region is identified as review PZ 1029-16, tract A1, A2, A3 of the subdivision of tract A for Industrial Design, Inc. Residential Parish of Local Government Subdivision is defined by Article 6 of Section 44 of Louisiana Constitution 1974. Whereas the Parish of Ascension is the governing responsible body over the zoning and regulations within the jurisdiction. Whereas Article 6 of the Home Rule Charter of Ascension Parish adopted May 4, 1993 identifies the process of managing to adopt ordinances regulating the lands of the parish. Whereas the official zoning map of Central Parish for Less adopted March 8, 2016. Whereas the Parish Council reserves the authority to make changes to the official zoning map by ordinance. Whereas the request has been processed in compliance with the procedures set forth, be it ordained by the Central Parish Governing Authority. The official zoning map of Central Parish, Louisiana is amended to reflect the property identified as Exhibit A as small plan unit development as the official zoning designation. In the event any portion of the ordinance is ever held invalid or unconstitutional for any reason by any court of competent jurisdiction over it, such portion shall be deemed separate, distinct, independent provisions and shall not affect the validity of any portions of the ordinance. The ordinance shall be in full effect as permitted by law. The exhibits are legal description, plat map, aerial zoning map, final development plan. The ordinance have been submitted to a vote. The vote thereon was as follows.
Open the public comment.
Open the public hearing by Mr. Sadler.
Second
by Mr. Cagliotti. Madam Secretary, I don't know if I've said it at the beginning, but I think we have a speaker here.
I'm Matt Davis with Stantec. I'm just here to represent the client if anybody has any questions.
Okay.
Motion closed.
Second.
Motion closed public hearing by Mr. Danny Johnson, second by Mr. Cagliotti. Chair would entertain a motion.
Some.
Motion by Mr. Cagliotti, second by Ms. Cazzo. Any discussion? Any opposition? Motion passes. We'll move on to agenda item number 15, reading of ordinance to provide for the incurring of debt and issuance of not to exceed $4,105,000 aggregate principal amount of the Parish of Ascension, State of Louisiana, Water Utility Revenue Bonds, ACUD1, refunding project. Mr. Parrington.
The following ordinance was previously introduced in written form at a regular meeting of the Parish Council on August 4, 2016 at the notice of public hearing, having been published in the official journal, which public hearing was held in accordance with said public notice, was offered by and seconded by as follows. An ordinance providing ordinance number so-and-so blank. An ordinance providing for the incurring of debt in issuance not to exceed $4,105,000 aggregate principal amount of the Parish of Ascension, State of Louisiana, water utility revenue bonds, Associated Consolidated Utilities District Number 1 refunding project, and in one or more series the bonds prescribing the form, terms, and conditions of the bonds and security therefore, designating the date, denominations, and place of payment of such bonds, providing for the payment of such bonds, and the principal interest in approving and confirming the sale of bonds, and providing for the other matters with respect to the bonds as attached here to is Exhibit A.
Chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing. Mr. Johnson, second by Mr. Cagnolotti.
Motion to close.
Motion closed by Mr. Sadler, second by Mr. Todd Lambert. Chair would entertain a motion.
So moved.
So a motion by Mr. Benny Johnson.
Second.
Second by Ms. Cazzo. Do we have bond counsel here?
Sure.
Can you guys step forward and just give us the cliff notes on this?
Sure.
For the good people of Ascension Parish and me.
Good evening. This is the bonds that we issued by ACUD back in, I think, 2007. And we've been watching for a while and realized that it was an opportune time to just basically refinance those bonds. And in looking at it, it was determined that it would even be a better deal if we did it through the parish as opposed through ACUD,
right?
Because you get a better bond rate. And our estimate would be that if the bonds are, I think our tentative closing date for this is September 29th. And it looks like if the interest rates hold up over the remaining life of the bonds, which is about 16 years, you'd incur a savings of over $500,000, which is about 15% of the value of the bonds.
Yeah, that's I just wanted to clip notes so everybody know why we do this. It's basically refinance and lower rates.
Correct.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dugan.
Motion to adopt.
Motion to adopt by Mr. Bill Dawson, second by Mr. Oliver Joseph. Any discussion? Any opposition? It is adopted. We'll move on to agenda item number 18. Reading of ordinance to acquire and purchase certain parcels of immovable property currently occupied by People's Water Company of Donaldsville that consists of land, easements, pipes, plants, valve, hydrants, and tanks.
To acquire and purchase certain parcel of immovable property currently occupied by People's Water Service Company of Donaldsville that consists of land, easements, pipes, plants, valves, hydrants, and tanks, whereas the Parish of Ascension, State of Louisiana, is authority to acquire and purchase property. Therefore, be it now ordained that the Ascension Parish Governing Authority authorize the acquisition and purchase of the property currently occupied by People's Water Service Company of Louisiana, consisting of land, easements, pipes, plants, valve, hydrants, and tanks, as more fully described in Exhibit A, attached hereto and made a part hereof. This ordinance is being adopted in conformity with Section 601 of the Ascension Parish Charter. Purchase of property is subject to approval by the Parish Attorney and the Ascension Parish Council. Parish Kenny Matassa, Parish President, is hereby authorized to sign all necessary documents on behalf of the parish, and is hereby authorized to sign all necessary documents on the parish of Ascension for the purchase of the property. The ordinance had been submitted to a vote. The vote they wrote on was as follows. This is just a companion to the acquisition. Right. These are all these, and we said we didn't have, they've had multiple changes in titles and mergers, so we just used the occupied by People's Water Service.
Sure. Thank you, sir.
Open.
Motion to open public hearing by Mr. Johnson, second by Ms. Cazzo.
Motion to close public hearing.
Motion to close by Mr. Oliver Joseph, second by Mr. Sadler. Chair would entertain a motion.
Motion to accept.
We have a motion by Mr. Joseph, second by Mr. Bill Dawson. Any discussion?
Mr. President?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes. Madam Secretary, please note that Councilman Turner abstains from any action on this subject. Any discussion? Any opposition? Motion passes. Before we go on to agenda item number 21, on behalf of all the council, and they can speak by themselves if they want to, I'll allow it. But we do appreciate all the parish workers, all the staff, everybody out there, all departments. The job is continuing on. The debris pickup is moving. It's It looks patchy sometimes. It looks incomplete sometimes. If it takes three passes, it's going to take three passes, and the parish will assist at getting just all the debris picked up, and it's going to be a while before it looks clean. And once again, I do thank all the parish workers and all the staff and all the departments. Any other council members got any closing remarks?
Mr. Chairman, before we go on, if I think just to make sure the public knows for sure, if you see people digging in your trash, they're authorized to do that. That's the hazardous materials that they have. They go along with the people who are picking up the trash and pick that up. So if you can call the police, but that they have a badge on them and everything, they're going out taking the hazardous materials out of the debris.
Okay. Good deal. I thought I had to separate it, man.
You were supposed to, but you didn't end up doing this.
You were supposed to, but people are hurting enough, so we add this little service.
Thanks. Do whatever we got to do. Chair would entertain a motion to adjourn. A motion by Mr. Cagnolotti, second by Ms. Cazzo. Any discussion? Any opposition? We are adjourned.